Hello, welcome back to the Oberheim OB-Xa tutorial series, and it's the good stuff. Here we've got a preset deep dive for you today. Got this sound, and it's an arpeggio. Let's figure out how this sound's built. Now, every synth has its own idiosyncrasies when you come to preset deep dives. How do you actually pull it to bits? With the synthesizers that have like hidden extra screens like this, I generally try to pull all of that stuff out so that I can concentrate on the main part of the synth and then bring the complex stuff in later. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. But I'm going to do it piecemeal so that as I'm pulling all of this stuff out, I've got a little bit of an opportunity to try to catch what each control is doing if I can. So, apart from the fact that it says noise level, and I can hear a tiny, tiny difference, it really is very, very subtle. We'll come back to that later. I don't need to turn the other three off because there's nothing set. Reverb is on, but set to nothing, so I'm not going to worry about that. Delay is clearly on and doing delay things, and we can tell that we've also got a chorus. Fairly subtle, but it's there. Just realized I didn't deal with the modulation matrix, so let's go back and fix that. We've got velocity mapped to volume, which sounds a bit weird, but basically it just accentuates the difference between lows and highs on your keyboard. Put a really soft key, loud key, and without that, soft, loud. I'll leave it out actually. Then we've got a couple of effects being applied to the mod wheel. So let's get my C going. Decent volume. This is the mod wheel all the way down. So, two different things. I let the key go there and the sound is still carrying on. So that's one thing. We're maximizing the release phase of the envelope as the modulation wheel goes up, but as well as doing that, we're pulling all the frequencies away using the low pass filter. So the combination of these two effects is marvelous. Fabulous fat sound, that is. I'm conscious of volumes here. Let's just pull that down a little bit. I'm going to leave that there because it sounds so good. Now, main synth. So we've got stereo stuff going on with our spread values. So all of these secret knobs are in action. Let's see what the oscillator's doing. So it's having a maximal effect. We can see it oscillating with our movement. I think it might be time to actually take the arpeggiator away for a moment. Now we can hear it. There we go. So there's the pulse. It's like it's coming from the LFO, but it isn't. The LFO is actually set very, very slow, and it's not doing this. It's actually coming from the stereo movement. If I take the oscillator movement away, now we're just hearing the filter. That's lovely and subtle, really, really nice. So that's a great example of using the stereo movements as an extra little LFO. Speaking of LFOs, the LFO is configured, but as I said earlier, we've got almost no rate and basically no depth. So we'll consider that perhaps a little bit later, but for now it's not doing anything, so I'm not going to worry about it. Quick look at the oscillators. We've got both oscillators on. Oscillator 2 is the louder of the two. They're both pulse waves, but oscillator 2 is slightly detuned by 19 cents. And that's giving us a nice thickness to the sound. If I get rid of that detune, put it back, It's subtle. All of these things are subtle. If you're struggling to hear something, make it more extreme and then bring it back. And your ears will kind of track it as it comes back in from the outer extremities of the galaxy. Really low filter cutoff set with masses of resonance. That's what giving us all that lovely resonance spike. And so now that we've got a good idea of the basic oscillator and filter setup, we can bring the arpeggiator back in. I'm playing C and E here. So we've obviously got two octaves and it's in as played mode as we can see. So I must have played EC then accidentally. Now then, that's our basic sound and we're starting to develop a good idea of what the synth's doing. Now let's head back into the advanced pages and see if we can make a little bit more sense of over there. Now, when we took this noise level value out, it didn't really seem to be having very much impact on the sound. Let's have another go. Now that we've got fewer things going on, no delays bouncing around and all that kind of stuff, we can actually hear that tiny little bit of noise kind of poking its head. When I was playing with this control while I was preparing for the deep dive, I just did this. I got a completely different effect. This is my mod wheel coming back in now. Listen to that. And I think this is an absolutely essential thing to take away from deep dives. Don't just learn what the sound does, and that's our primary directive. We want to try and deconstruct the sound. But at every opportunity, give yourself the chance to stretch your muscles. What happens if I do this? If you come across something that is, in your opinion, an improvement on the original sound, then awesome, save it as a preset and you're up and running. And I think, you know, just pulling that attack back and having the full effect of the noise is better to my ears. Now let's go back over to the effects units and have a bit more of a look at these. We'll deal with chorus first. So again, I really want to hear it. And then bring it back. Oh, it's lovely stereo. It's quite rare to see feedback on chorus effects. That's usually reserved for flanges. But let's give it a play. I feel like it. This level. Cavernous. Fabulous. Getting carried away. I must stop. Pull that back down. I've messed around with so many things. I'm actually going to throw all of that away and get back to our stock sound. And now we get to hear the delay back in. There it is. Let's have a bit of play with the width. Yeah, that's nice. And of course, even though the reverb's not on, that doesn't stop us putting it on if we want to. Just getting us back to our standard original sound. And what I want to do now is try and figure out what the LFO is doing. We've got LFO plugged in on the stereo control and we've got a load of stuff configured, but with the depth at zero, we're not hearing it. So I want to know what it's doing and why it's there. I'm going to have a bit of a play and try and home in on it and find what it's doing. So easiest thing to do is make an extreme, and then hopefully we'll catch it. We've got a sample and hold effect going on here with key trigger. The arpeggiator is as effective a key trigger as hitting a note. In other words, the synthesizer interprets every one of the arpeggiator's notes as a key trigger. So I don't have to spam the key. I can just hold it down with the arpeggiator on and I'll find it. Okay, so there's the pitch variance. Obviously a massive depth. Now start pulling it back. And even at tiny depths, actually, just those really subtle variances of pitch are identifiable. Perhaps if I mess with the rate. So this is how often a new snapshot's being taken by the sample and hold module. See, that's too much. That's it, nice and slow. And stick at that level and then very subtly change and pull all these values back down again. Then we get back to the state where it's a usable sound rather than a silly sound effect. And now finally, I get to play with, as I've been going through and doctoring the sound, finding the things that I really like. I really like that. I liked a little bit more chorus. That depth was pretty great. Increase my delay and give me tons of width as well. Little bit of reverb, and then play with my modulation wheel on a nice statically held chord. Let's find something. Fabulous, absolutely fabulous. That's my first deep dive. Hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, please do consider subscribing. I'll catch you for deep dive number 2. Thanks very much for watching.